so long, the bar of racism has been set by the easily condemnable activity of white extremists and white nationalism. The white extremists are always roundly condemned by the big three political parties. The reactionary white pride sentiment, so often positioned in opposition to social progress, has never really gone away. It manifests in the ebb and flow of groups like the National Front, the British National Party, and the English Defence League. Their political activity, whether it is storming down busy streets in hoodies and balaclavas, or suited up and feigning respectability at their political conferences, has real-life consequences for people who aren't white and British. If all racism was as easy to spot, grasp, and denounce as white extremism is, the task of the anti-racist would be simple. Then there's the glaringly obvious point. If white extremism really is the bar at which we set all racism, why and how does racism thrive in quarters in which those in charge do not align themselves with white extremist politics? The problem must run deeper. We tell ourselves that good people can be racist. We seem to think that true racism only exists in the hearts of evil people. We tell ourselves that racism is about moral values, when instead it is about the survival strategy of systemic power. When swathes of the population vote for politicians and political efforts that explicitly use racism as a campaigning tool, we tell ourselves that huge sections of the electorate simply cannot be racist, as that would render them heartless monsters. But this isn't about good and bad people. The covert nature of structural racism is difficult to hold to account. It slips out of your hands easily, like a water snake toy. You can't spot it as easily as a St. George flag and a bare belly at an English Defence League march. It's much more respectable than that. I appreciate that the word structural can feel and sound abstract. Structural. What does that even mean? I choose to use the word structural rather than institutional because I think it is built into spaces much broader than our more traditional institutions. Thinking of the big picture helps you see the structures. Structural racism is dozens or hundreds or thousands of people with the same biases joining together to make up one organization and acting accordingly. Structural racism is an impenetrably white workplace culture set by those people, where anyone who falls outside of the culture must conform or face failure. Structural is often the only way to capture what goes unnoticed. The silently raised eyebrows, the implicit biases, snap judgments made on perceptions of competency. In the same year that I decided to no longer talk to white people about race, the British Social Attitude Survey saw a significant increase in the number of people who were happy to admit to their own racism. The sharpest rise in those self-admitting were, according to a Guardian report, white professional men between the age of 35 and 64, highly educated and earning a lot of money. This is what structural racism looks like. It is not just about personal prejudice, but the collective effects of bias. It is the kind of racism that has the power to drastically impact people's life chances. Highly educated, highly earning white men are very likely to be landlords, bosses, CEOs, head teachers, or university vice chancellors. They are almost certainly people in positions that influence others' lives. They're almost certainly the kind of people who set workplace cultures. They are unlikely to boast about their politics with colleagues or acquaintances because of the social stigma of being associated with racist views. But their racism is covert. It doesn't manifest itself in spitting at strangers in the street. Instead, it lies in an apologetic smile when explaining to an unlucky soul that they didn't get the job. It manifests itself in the flick of a wrist that tosses a CV in the bin because the applicant has a foreign-sounding name. The national picture is grim. Research from a number of different sources shows how racism is weaved into the fabric of our world. This demands a collective redefinition of what it means to be racism, how racism manifests, and what we must do to end it. It seems like black people face a disadvantage at every significant step in their lives. Let's say that a black boy starts his first day at school, the first British institution he will pass through independent of his parents. Mom and dad are full of hope for what he might become, an artist, a doctor, the next prime minister, and this is where he will set himself up to achieve those wished-for goals. But perhaps his parents should temper their excitement, because evidence suggests that the odds will be stacked against him. According to the Department of Education, a black schoolboy in England is around three times more likely to be permanently excluded compared to the whole school population. But let's say that our black boy, and it's always a boy, there's little to no research in this area focused on the life chances of black girls, avoids being excluded and makes it far enough into his school journey to take exams. He won't be explicitly aware of the invisible barriers placed in his way, but they will exist. At the age of 11, when he's preparing to take his SATs, research indicates that he will be systemically marked down by his own teachers, a phenomenon that is remedied by when examiners who don't teach at his school mark his exam papers. It will take anonymity to get him the grades he deserves. In the spirit of optimism, let us insist that our imaginary black child gets into a good secondary school, studies a subject he loves, and becomes determined to go to university. The evidence suggests his fortunes might drastically change as a greater proportion of black students than white students progress to higher education after sixth form or college. But along race lines, access to Britain's prestigious universities is unequal, with black students less likely to be accepted into a high-ranking, research-intensive Russell Group University than their white counterparts. Perhaps the black child, now blossoming into an adult, has got the grades he deserves, he needed, and is accepted into a good university, despite the odds being stacked against him. 3 years later, and he's furiously refreshing his university's result page, eagerly awaiting the degree classification that will be his ticket to graduate employment. He's hoping for a 2.1 at least, but has his fingers crossed for a first, because all the job ads he browsed so far explicitly mention that graduates with a 2.2 degree or lower shouldn't waste their time applying. Although we don't want to pour a bucket of water over his dreams, it's not looking good. Between 2012 and 2013, the highest proportion of UK students to receive the lowest degree ranking, a third or a pass, was among black students, with the lowest proportion being white students. Given that black kids are more likely than white kids to move into higher education, it's spurious to suggest that this attainment gap is down to a lack of intelligence, talent, or aspiration. It's worth looking at the distinct lack of black and brown faces teaching at university to see what might contribute to this systemic failure. In 2016, it was revealed by the Higher Education Statistics Agency that almost 70% of the professors teaching in British universities are white men. It's a dire indication of what universities think intelligence looks like. Because he exists in this book only to make a point, we can imagine that the young black man makes it out of education in one piece, with a good degree from a good university and his eyes fixed upon getting a good job, like all determined graduates. Although he won't know it, outside of education, the drastic racial disparities continue. He might look at the white kids he went to university with and watch them effortlessly transition from student, booze, culture-loving lagerlouts to slick young professional status. Full of hope, our black boy will still continue to send out CVs because he believes in meritocracy. There's no difference between him and his white peers, he thinks. They sat in the same lectures and read the same books. But his potential employers might not see it that way. In 2009, researchers working on behalf of the Department of Work and Pensions sent job applications with similar education, skills, and work history to a number of prospective employers. The only distinctive difference in the applications were names. They either sounded white British or they didn't. The researchers found that the applicants with white-sounding names were called to interview far more often than those with African or Asian-sounding names. High levels of name-based net discrimination were found in favor of white applicants, the report commented. So, our young black man could find himself unemployed and scraping by for a very long time. Research in 2012 found that austerity was hitting young black men particularly hard when their demographic facing a sharp rise in unemployment predating even the 2008 recession. A staggering 45% of black 16 to 24-year-olds were out of work in 2012 compared with just 27% in 2002. More broadly, ethnic minority people in England and Wales have historically dealt with lower rates of employment and higher rates of unemployment than white people. Looking at 20 years of census data between 1991 and 2011, you'll see that black men have had consistently higher rates of unemployment, more than double of their white counterparts. The same disadvantage is echoed in black Caribbean women and black African women compared to white women. There is more to life than getting a good education and a decent job, though. Productivity alone does not make a worthwhile human being. What about our young black man's social and personal life? On his way to meet friends or to school or work, he might find himself stopped and searched by the police. In fact, he will almost certainly have some contact with the police. A 2013 British report revealed that black people are twice as likely to be charged with drugs possession, despite lower rates of drug use. Black people are also more likely to receive a harsher police response, being five times more likely to be charged rather than cautioned or warned for possession of drugs. That probably won't come as a surprise to him, though, and he will be used to the feeling of an overbearing police presence in his life. He will have almost certainly seen his brothers, uncles, and older male friends routinely patted down by the police. In fact, relentless policing of the black community in Britain means that black people are overrepresented on the National Criminal Intelligence DNA database. Although there's no recent official figures, a 2009 report from the Equalities and Human Rights Commission estimated that roughly 30% of all black men living in Britain are on the National DNA database, compared with about 10% of white men and 10% of Asian men. They also estimated that black men are about four times more likely than white men to have their DNA profiles stored on the police database. This led to the commission to comment, "We are concerned that the high proportion of black men recorded on the database, estimated to be at least one in three black men, is creating an impression that a single race group represents an alien wedge of criminality." Thank you.